Thursday night football is live on Twitch TV, everybody. Welcome to the Final Split, episode number 53. We have an interesting situation for the next couple of episodes. So Spike is in a play, and he will be taking kind of a short break from us to be working on that. So we'll be filling his box with various people or pictures of him for the next few episodes. As you can see here, he's ready to go catch that football. We got wide receiver Spike Fujita over there. Maybe tight end Spike Fujita. I don't know what his position would be there, but one or the other. It looks like he's ready anyway to make the catch. But so we're gonna go without him today, and we've got Darkman returning as usual. How are you doing?
Great. So like, when everybody was like going like all crazy over Legacy Collection when it released on Tuesday, yeah, I was like, let me stream Mega Man 5. Literally booted up the stream, didn't even reset, and I got a PB. So
I love those streams.
That's like the first and only time that's ever gonna happen. So,
and everybody else was getting frustrated at Mega Man Legacy Collection.
Pretty much. There's like nobody watching my stream. It was great.
Oh, so you got it all to yourself then?
Okay. Yeah, pretty much.
Nice. That's really good. Yeah, I understand. You know, that's not one of our topics, but we might as well just bring it up because everybody's going to be talking about it anyway. So, Mega Man Legacy Collection, it exists.
I mean, honestly, the only real complaints are honestly complaints that we as speedrunners would have.
Yeah,
I feel like as a game itself, I think it's a good game. It's just like things like input lag, which are really unbearable for me, aren't really things like your core audience are really going to complain about. So overall, I think it's solid. The challenges are really fun, great concept. So
yep, and I mean obviously the leaderboard's there as well, so
yep.
Speedrunners getting some advertising there. They're getting a chance to put their name out there. So I saw a couple of times like Cool Kid would be on the top of a leaderboard. Instead of it saying Cool Kid, it would say twitch.tv/thebigboy.
So that was good.
Looks like people are taking advantage of that. And Garrison is our guest this week. Garrison, hey. Clean-shaven Garrison is here with us. How are you doing?
I'm doing pretty well. Just got home from work and went immediately on the show, so I am in good spirits.
That's good. Well, hopefully you got a little bit of a break anyway before the show started and you're not...
I did. I got some delicious water and a couple microwave taquitos, so that's going to hold me over.
Nice. Thank you for saying microwave, too, because now it justifies the episode name. So people are going to be wondering, what does the microwave got to do with anything? But
my webcam goes down. It's not me.
That's right.
That'd be great if it actually happens.
Oh, if it happens during the... now that we said it, it probably will, so... Yeah. We'll keep an eye out for it here. All right, let's go ahead and get right into it here with our first topic. And that topic is AGDQ 2016. It's not that far away, actually. Hard to think about it like that. But the dates have been announced. The location has been announced. And we've got AGDQ 2016, January 3rd through the 9th at the Hilton Washington Dulles, which was the same hotel that it was at last year. So knowing that, what do you guys think about going back to that same hotel? I mean, obviously we got done talking about SGDQ and the, you know, what people liked and didn't like about that hotel. AGDQ, I feel like there were a lot of concerns last year with that venue.
Mm-hmm.
Are they still around or what do we think?
I mean, yeah, they still are. I mean, I've mentioned this on that show, but you know, AGDQ 15 was honestly like a big letdown for me. You know, I didn't really feel too good about it afterwards. And that was in no small part because of the hotel. It's a great hotel. Like, don't get me wrong. Like, the actual inside of it, you know, everything like in the inside of it went great. It's just its location is complete garbage. It's in no man's land. And, you know, I mean, when I saw we're going back, I mean, I wasn't that shocked. Kind of felt like it was going to happen. But, you know, they seem like they're trying to take some steps to make sure that, you know, the fact that it is in the middle of no man's land isn't going to hurt us as much. They've been talking about like food truck options. They've been talking about, you know, more aggressive shuttling of people to various places. So if that happens, that'd be great. But, you know, I'm cautious, you know, I'm hoping that things will turn out great, but, you know, I'm also realistic. So I have a feeling the same sort of issues that popped up last year are probably going to pop up in some form again this year.
Gary, you feel the same way?
I mean, sight unseen, I don't know how exactly it's going to change, but from what I've read, I'm not too hopeful on the food situation still. I don't have a whole lot of faith that it's going to be better, but luckily a lot of my friends have cars.
Yeah.
The hotel itself is nice.
And those friends are the ones that are going around saying that they're not looking forward to it because they know that
exactly.
That they're responsible for the food then. Yeah. I mean, I think this is one of those things where, you know, we talked about when we were discussing SGDQ feedback that it's so important that there's communication going on, because even if the food situation can't be improved, if you can, you know, let us know that going into it so we can prepare for it, or, you know, have a plan of who we're going to talk to about getting food, just details like that are going to make a difference as far as how people react to the event itself, I think. So
my curious thing is that, you know, they stopped the whole free catered meal, that kind of thing. I understand why. Like, it was definitely a big headache, and I'm sure required a lot of effort on their part. But it's kind of like, I feel like maybe that might be like something to introduce again. Like, I feel like, I guess maybe the food truck option is kind of like the alternative to that. But like, it'd be cool if they could like reconsider that, because that would be perfect for this type of venue, you know, to have that meal that, you know, you don't have to drive out for.
Yeah. I mean, people talking about food trucks in the chat there too. I mean, that's been discussed. I think people are saying that there's the possibility that we would see some food trucks there, or concession stands or something of that sort.
They did confirm that the food trucks are going to be there. We just don't know the details yet. So.
Okay. So at least it sounds like the situation is going to be better than it was last year. So if you survive last year, you're probably going to survive this year too. But
somehow Papa John's will.
Papa John's will be doing good business then.
The real question is our good friend the curling waiter there? Is he still there?
Oh.
Do you remember the do you remember the curling waiter?
I remember that guy.
A very interesting waiter. It might even be the same guy. I don't think with you guys, but you like. Threw bread at BJW,
yep.
And then he patted me on the back and he was like, "You're a good man."
Yep.
And just like no explanation.
He curled the there was like a bowl of bread, and he just like curled it onto the table, and it knocked over BJW's water or something. He just spilled it all over the table.
Really funny.
Yeah.
He hated BJW for some reason.
Like, maybe. Yeah.
It looked like, yeah, why would you let me throw this bread at you or something?
Yeah.
I mean, not to go overlooked is the dates itself. I mean, it's not like I was really that shocked either by the dates, but it's definitely more of a concern this time around, especially for people flying in, because that is literally the first, you know, January 1st weekend, the New Year's weekend. So it's definitely going to have an effect on prices. And I wonder if that's maybe going to detract certain people from coming, whereas they would be able to come no problem.
Yeah, I mean, usually those first few days, like, you know, January 1st itself, and then I think even like the 2nd or 3rd, it'll still be around that same price, you know, the price hike there. So,
yeah,
I mean, last year, I want to say the event was the 4th to the 10th. So it wasn't too much different.
Yeah.
But
like the 1st was on Thursday. So most likely people were probably flying home on Friday, something like that, rather than waiting until Sunday.
That's
who knows?
True.
I mean, it was probably less likely they're flying, but now when it's on a Friday, well, everybody's got off on Friday. So, hey, we'll take a weekend, you know? So
yeah, we'll actually, I do have one funny thing to say about the pricing being so close to New Year's Day. It's actually almost $200 cheaper for me to fly on the 1st.
Yeah. Did you fly on New Year's itself?
So I'm going to fly a day early and spend some of that money on a hotel and just stay there a day.
Nice.
Interesting. Okay. Something to keep in mind, I guess, if you're planning already.
I guess that makes sense, because like, who wants to fly on New Year's Day, especially because it's a weekend, you know? So that, I guess that's an advantage, you know, if people want to fly out that early. If people can share a room, it doesn't cost them too much.
Something to keep in mind. Now, something else about the hotel to consider, are we still going to have the sliding shower doors for the bathrooms?
Oh man, what an experience.
Somebody, I don't remember who it was, somebody told me that they had that experience at SGDQ this time around. They still had the sliding shower door. It just like followed them from AGDQ to SGDQ, but I can't remember who told me that. So if it was you should tweet at me.
Pretty terrible.
Yeah.
One thing that people forget about too is the blinds of this hotel. Like, I remember hearing from a couple people that they literally got their pants belts and tied their blinds together so they could have the room dark.
To keep it dark? They weren't staying? Oh, interesting.
Oh, man. Okay. I don't remember that issue in our room, but
it may not have been in every room. It's definitely in the room that I was in.
I see.
Yeah. I mean, the venue itself, I thought for the most part, people seemed pretty okay with. I mean, the setup is kind of interesting that they'd have that marathon room right next to that practice room there, and I think it worked out pretty well. So, yeah, I think it's just kind of, you know, more of the, what do you want to say, extracurricular, that's not the word I'm looking for, but like the things that don't necessarily directly relate to the marathon itself that are going to be.
That's what's going to suffer, but it suffers anyway at AGDQ just due to the nature of winter time.
Sure. Very true. All right. Well, we'll look at it and see what's going on as, you know, time goes on. We'll find out more details. So we'll keep an eye out for anything else that might be interesting to talk about. But for now, why don't we talk with Garrison since he's here, and we'll go ahead and do a little interview here. All right. I don't even know where to begin because I feel like you've got enough stuff to talk about that we could just do that instead of any of the other topics we planned. But do you want to just maybe fill people in on when you got started speedrunning? What got you into speedrunning and like what game kind of drew you in?
Yeah, absolutely. I first got started speedrunning back in like 2009, and it actually came from not viewing SDA videos like everyone else tells me, but Let's Plays. I was watching some Let's Plays on YouTube or something, and they were talking about Super Metroid and how I think the quote was something like, real players can, or good players can beat the game in under an hour, real players can beat it without speed booster. And that kind of appealed to me for whatever reason, and I just did like, I beat the game with as few things as I could, which was probably like 25% or something like that. And I was just like, oh, I'm going to do this again. And I kept going down in the game time. I was just like, this is really fun. And I was involved with other online communities doing other things. And I actually played Forum Mafia with Vorpal Edge, Meat Boy Runner.
Yep.
And he happened to be promoting AGDQ 2011, I think, saying, oh, I'm going to be playing Super Metroid here. And it's like, oh, I try and beat Super Metroid fast. Let me watch this. And I watched that marathon, and I basically fell in love with the hobby. And I took it a lot more seriously. And eventually, I found out about Speedruns Live from watching Giano do Ocarina of Time Bingo. And I was just like, I'm dropping Super Metroid. I can become an OOT main.
Yeah.
That for about a week. And then I was racing Super Metroid on SRL. And that's how I started, really.
So, I mean, if it wasn't for this Let's Play, you know, that challenged you to beat Super Metroid with restrictions, I mean, do you think you would have still found speedrunning just later on, or?
Probably much later, like 2014, 2015, something like that. Wow. I think it was just very much a time and place thing, but given the nature of how much it's expanded, I would have probably found it eventually.
Yeah, and I mean, this was back when, like you mentioned, like Bingo was popular. The weekly races for Super Metroid, those were maybe starting to get big shortly after. I don't think they started up until you guys had been playing for a while, right?
Oh, yeah. Like Super Metroid racing was pretty dismal when I first showed up. Like it was, my understanding is Vorpal and Elminster would race every now and then. They'd do like, oh, let's get 30% or whatever. All these weird, obscure SRL races, like go get high jump boots. And then my good friend MSDS was begging people for Super Metroid races for a long time and no one would. And eventually I came out of the scene. And I was just like, oh, well, I want to play Ocarina of Time, but I'll race Super Metroid. I know that game. Whatever.
Yeah.
And we would just chain any percent, and that just kind of grew and grew and grew until all of a sudden we had more and more people. And we sort of, I don't want to say we started the weekly thing because that was more like 96 exit from Super Mario World. Mm-hmm. But we're definitely one of the first primary weekly races. And that stemmed from us getting in contact with the Japanese runners and setting up a time and a place to have a single race.
Yeah, just, I mean, it was kind of the first example, or at least prominent example of like an attempt to reach out to the Japanese community and pull them into what we were doing with Super Metroid. And the best part about it was how consistently they would show up. I mean, they really were there every Friday for those races.
Mm-hmm. They really loved it. It was pretty amazing because we are all big racing fans, and there's always like, I don't know, I'd say 4 to 7 people who would take first, and all of a sudden our pool of players expanded, almost doubled, and it's just like anyone could win. Mm-hmm. It's just, it was a very interesting time to be playing Super Metroid.
Was there somebody that like isn't active in Super Metroid anymore that was and kind of stood out to you during that time? Is there somebody that, because I know like Imodaron comes to mind, somebody who would show up every Friday to play, and then mm-hmm. I think he said he was going to be working on a ROM hack or something, and then hasn't really.
Yeah, he decided to work on a ROM hack, and then he disappeared for like a year and a half, and then one day he showed up and just joined the race, and he knew all the current strategy.
He just was back.
That yeah. game changed so much, and just like, oh, I guess he's been keeping up, and then he disappeared again, so one day we'll see him motor on again.
Yeah.
So kind of take us maybe like kind of like the build up to, I guess, AGT 13. Like, I mean, I don't know really the whole history of how your like, you know, RTA history went, but like, I definitely saw you like a lot in 2012, kind of chasing that, you know, that really good time. Like I saw you cut the Hoda Ruby, and I mean, that was such a huge milestone. And then if you like bring it down all the way, I don't know, you probably had like a 47 or something like that by AGT 13.
Yeah, so, I did.
Mm-hmm. Kind of like take us through like, you know, like, What was your like motivation then? Was it just kind of like the I want to cut like Hoda Ruby, or I want to cut this guy or whatever, or was it just kind of like I just want to keep, you know, playing this game until I don't like it anymore?
My biggest motivation was definitely beating Hoda Ruby. Like that was my mission statement as a Super Metroid speedrunner yeah. from the time I started like experimenting with doing RTA over races, because originally I was just a racer. I just race the game and have fun. But I just saw this run, and I was just like, I'm going to beat that run one day. It's going to be years from now, but I'm going to do it. And it just got more and more realistic as we developed like real-time strategies to cut time. And it was just like, well, I can't really touch his game time, but we're going to beat his real time, because he was the first person to do real time in Super Metroid.
Right.
And it's just like, he really didn't optimize for real time at all, but I'm going to beat him.
Yeah.
I can't beat him the other way.
You'll beat him this other roundabout way, yeah. I mean, do you remember the run when you beat him?
Yeah, I remember the first run I thought I beat him. I ended up tying him because it was mistimed or something like that by a second or something like that. And I was just so frustrated by the fact that I tied him. I've just got like a history of tying people's records or being tied. It's ridiculous. Yeah. But the run that I actually beat him, I decided, because there's a lot of things that we were always talking about, oh, in theory it'd be faster to skip this E-tank or whatever, yeah, a whole lot riskier, but you know, it's a do or die moment, you got to do it. And I just happened to skip the Ridley E-tank, which we were all getting at that time, because it's just, you have no health leaving lower Norfair. I was just like, no, it's too risky. You're not, just don't throw away the run. And I was just like, you know what? This is the only way I can beat him right now, is to go ahead and just skip the.
So you just decided on a whim.
Mm-hmm.
And it ended
That's
up
really what
out.
I like about the game, is just having to make those decisions. It's just like, I got to do this to make up for that and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I mean, it continues to be a game where people are asking the question of what if we don't do this, or what if we did it this way? It's. You know, you'd think by now that that any percent route would be just defined and stable, and it's just a matter of refining it, but it's still changing. It's still different every year, it mm-hmm. seems so.
Well, people have these expectations of what the game, what is possible and what isn't, and I've learned one thing in speedrunning, it's just that don't set expectations, because people right. will find ways around them.
Yeah, because I mean, how many times Super Metroid is a great example of that too, where people said, you know, oh, it's definitely worth getting Spazer, and then they changed their mind and said it's definitely not worth getting Spazer, and then they changed their mind again, now we need Spazer. So I mean, it just seems like that is a community that constantly questions what's possible, what's, you know, nobody is satisfied with what's out there at the moment.
Absolutely. I mean, reminds me of my good friend Jackifer when he first came back to speedrunning, because he went away for like 2 years. Mm-hmm. And he's just like starting to go for the record in Mischief Makers. And he's asking me, oh, how'd you do it? And just the way I put it was just like, you know, sometimes you have these ideas and people will be like, oh, you're an idiot, but you got to be that idiot to get a top time in a game. Just embrace it and become the idiot.
Become the idiot. Life advice.
Wow. So post HGT 13, you kind of went on a grind with this game. I mean, it seemed like you were streaming like almost every day. I mean, just trying to get a...
going ham with that game after AGDQ, because what had happened is at that time, like, I had started getting more viewers and I became a bigger stream just as far as speedrunners go, and I had gotten partner immediately after AGDQ, so I was just like, oh, I owe it to these people to keep going, I gotta keep going, and my viewer base just kept growing and growing, and I was just like, I gotta just do this. I admittedly pushed myself very hard. Like, I was doing on work days, like 5 hours a night, and on days off, anywhere from like 8 to 14 hours of Super Metroid.
Wow.
And then when my stream wasn't on, I'd have it on in the background, practicing like here and there. Just, it was always on.
Yeah.
Do you feel like that was like a major reason to kind of just getting burned out from the game, or?
Oh, absolutely. It's just like, there's been a lot of instances with me in that game where I just got burnt out. Like, I remember there was one week where I didn't see Kraid. That kind of thing just really gets to me. I don't know. Some people, like Zost, he can just beat his head against that game eternally. But
yeah.
Was a part of you kind of like relieved when like Zost came on and just started like pushing it more? They're like, oh, hey, I don't need to be that guy anymore. I can, you know, kind of like, you know, be in the background, kind of support him. And
Zost is kind of an interesting person, because when we first saw him, my buddy Twig pointed out Zost and he's just like, oh, this is a really good player. And he was getting like, Zost PB was like a 53 or something when the record was like a 46. And like, we saw him and just like, yeah, this guy's going to be the best one day. Even with that bad time, it was just like something about the way he was talking and playing, even though he was way far off. It's just like, yeah, this guy is capable of a lot.
Yeah.
There haven't been very many people like that I've seen in the speedrun community where it's just like, yep, I'm sold.
You had the full scouting report on him. You just knew you could just tell by watching him. Mm-hmm. Interesting. I'm trying to think now. So you kind of mentioned like the AGDQ 2013, kind of the big push after that was over, where, you know, your viewership started to go up. I want to say that was still around the time when I think Cosmo and Poxnor were maybe the only two that had subscriber at that point in the speedrunning community. I mean, there might have been a few others, but I feel like they were the
sub goes. It was Cosmo, Sig, Worcester, and another person. I don't remember who it was.
Maybe Trix. I don't know.
Trix. Yeah, it had to have been Trix.
Mm-hmm.
And then I got partner. I was like the sixth or seventh speedrun partner.
Yeah, that was definitely a time where just because you had partner doesn't mean you automatically get sub. So sub was an even loftier goal.
Oh, sub was ridiculous. Like, you had to be pulling in like a few thousand viewers on average.
Yeah, and I remember people would apply multiple times, like because the standards were so uncertain, that you could apply, you know, 5-6 times in a row and get rejected the first five, and then the sixth time they just let you in for no, you know, nothing has changed about your stream.
Quit bugging us.
Right. Yeah, they're just like, all right, fine.
That's how it was for me. I got in on like my fifth application for burner or something like that.
And then, so that happens, and then you kind of stepped back for a while, and kind of wanted to take it easy, just didn't want to.
Part of it was, like, my goal in mind with Super Metroid, and a lot of my viewers were there for Super Metroid. It wasn't so much that they're sold on me as a person. It's just like, oh, this guy's really good at Super Metroid. My goal was to beat Hoda Ruby. I beat him in real time, and then I ended up getting a 30, and once I got that 30, I kind of just... like, okay, I did it. I put the game down and decided to play other stuff instead.
Right.
And I just got really tired of the where's Super Metroid.
Yeah, absolutely. And I mean, you found a bunch of other games that you know you found equal success in. I mean, do you want to talk a little bit about some of those other games?
I think immediately after Super Metroid, a game I learned was Donald Land, which I'd watch Cool Kid play Donald Land, and I was just like, this game is crazy, because Like, it has no sense of scrolling whatsoever. And just like, this is a really good run. I'm going to learn this. So I think I may have accidentally birthed the first meme game before that term was coined.
Yeah.
I played that for about a month, yeah.
Yeah, and just as recently as yesterday, right?
Oh, yeah, I brought it back. My friend Deusler, I was over at his house last week or something like that. And he's just like, you should bring back Donald Land. So it was like, okay. And then I started playing it that night.
And now, what's the ending to that story, though? Because that's not it. You played it, but you also...
I beat the record. The world's record.
Beat the world's record. There we go.
Beat my friend Kloster by 2 whole seconds. Got a 13-18.
Oh, boy.
That is... So Donald Land is back now?
Donald Land's back. I'm going to be pushing that for a few more days.
A few more.
I like the description.
Yeah. It's a limited time offer, I guess. That's they got a new deal. So other than Donald Land, I mean, you played Donkey Kong Country.
Yep.
Quite a few times. You got a chance to show that off in GDQs.
That game still by 1 whole second. I really enjoyed watching THAP play that game like in 2011, 2012, and it was just really fun, and I learned it with Reflected, who ended up tying me with a world record later on, which was really cool. It's one thing to be tied with someone that you're competing against. It's another thing to be tied with like a friend of yours.
Mm-hmm.
But that was pretty neat, and I just kind of stuck with that game off and on. And it was a game that I really love. I still love that game. Like, I am not burnt out on Donkey Kong Country at all. But I just don't give it a whole lot of time. It's just like 3 weeks to 6 weeks at most.
And then you got to go back to Donald Land. That's
Donald Land or some crappy NES game that no one Super like, Contra 7.
Nice. I've never seen you. Have you actually streamed that?
Yeah, I've got the record, man.
Not really. Nice.
Good. I'll stream it for you someday.
There we go.
Nice. I look forward to it. So, I mean, you kind of definitely gravitate towards like those NES, SNES like platformers. Is there like particular inspiration that you pick in particular ones, or is it just kind of, hey, I see, you know, you see somebody else play that game and you're like, hey, that looks cool. Let's play it.
I don't know. It's kind of weird because I spend a lot of time thinking about like, oh, I really want to pick up this project. And I think about it for a long time, but that's usually not the games I ended up playing. It's usually like spur of the moment. It's just like, okay, yeah, I'll learn this. Like another example is I learned NES Star Wars, like because Striker's just like, I need someone to learn this game with me. And I was like, all right.
Just because somebody else tells you to.
But I've also been talking about like Zelda 1 and Super Mario Brothers 3 for probably years now at this point.
1 year.
Oh, we got a lot of Bioforce Ape fans in the chat as well.
BFA is good. Me, yeah. Cassius, and Cool Kid, we all used to race that. Was a good time.
I was going to ask you, too, about Number SMW, because it keeps popping back into my head.
Mm-hmm.
But do you remember what games you played in Number SMW? And
yeah.
What did you play?
Super Metroid, Bioforce Ape. We raced Harvest Moon.
That's right.
Any all days.
I almost forgot about that. We did.
Wait, you did any all days?
We slept any a lot. Days. Yeah. I think the run was at like 3 in the morning or something, and we needed an hour to kill or something. So Harvest Moon all days.
That was nice. Back when people got really mad at Twitch emotes, and we're just like spam try hard for an hour.
Yeah, it's funny. Like about Number SMW. Like before that marathon, I like hated emotes. And I don't know, it's just something about that marathon that made me like really embrace them. I don't
know how to describe it to anybody that in a way that they'll believe it. But I mean, we had a few thousand people watching that marathon. Yeah.
And I mean, that was crazy.
No matter what you told the chat, they would obey. They were obedient. Like if you're like, we need some dog face, they would spam it. And then if you said, hold on, we gotta explain something here. We're gonna put a link in chat. Like they just stop. Every one of them would stop. It was, I don't know, it was unbelievable just how coordinated they were. But
it just got like full on crazy during the SMRPG race between Cypher and Oxus. Like just the whole chat was just lost in an emote frenzy. It was great. And then eventually it became into a door six frenzy.
That's right. Yeah. I mean, did you have like a favorite memory from either Number SMW or just like another online marathon that you were part of?
Well, Number SMW is definitely the marathon closest to my heart because I think it was Yumi Dram who did most of the planning, and then Sloop got heavily involved. And favorite moments, I don't know. I hate to sound selfish, but I really enjoyed racing Super Metroid with my pal MSDS and then having Twig come on in the middle of the run. And just like, Cot Power just beat your record, man.
I remember that. Cot Power.
Like, this is the middle of the run, dude. Why would you tell me that now?
Cot Power one-upped you guys because he was streaming during that race. I remember that.
Oh,
yeah.
That's great.
I think the other, if I remember correctly, DBX is doing commentary. Mm-hmm. And he's explaining the Kraid quick kill. And I think you both miss it as he's explaining it. Like, I miss it. Oh, I missed it too.
Yeah, that sounds about right. You also did a cave story immediately afterwards. That was a fun marathon in general. I really enjoyed the success that we had for all of it.
Yeah, I mean, I think it kind of established that online marathons could work. I mean, there have been a lot of good ones since then, but I feel like Number SMW was really kind of the proving ground where community members who just wanted to do something outside of a GDQ could do it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I feel like it was the first of its kind. I don't remember.
I'm trying to remember the order. I mean, was Japan,
we had Spookython immediately before, right?
Oh yeah, there was Japanese really done quick. Yep. JRDQ, however you say it. Yeah, I mean there was that. It's true.
I was trying to remember. I'm pretty sure that came first, but I mean, but like, you know what I mean.
I kind of label it as like the GDQs. Like it has that deeply like that name to it. So I just kind of think of it as that, and don't remember that that happened.
Yeah, I mean, this was really just like a community. Yeah. Effort, like, hey, we just want to do a marathon with our friends for, you know, to help. I think it was just to help get people to AGDQ.
Mm-hmm.
And it just kind of blew up from there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it was interesting. I actually talked about this in #5OCU a week ago. I was just like, you know what? I just realized every single run that we had in Number SMW, it wasn't like a submission process. It was us as planners asking people to do runs for us. That's just not really something you see anymore.
Right. It's very different. You just kind of approached people and said, hey, is there anything you want to play in this marathon?
Yeah.
Okay, I can offer this. All right. Good. We'll see you then.
did you guys like actually like tell people, hey, all right, run this? Like, you didn't even like give them the option.
I mean, how else do you think Booty Hunt got in? You had to ask for it, right?
I mean, why would you have to ask somebody to run Booty Hunt?
I don't know. You shouldn't have to.
You shouldn't have to. Once Booty Hunt again.
That's a good question. I still remember that run too. I mean, that was the pause right at the end before he goes into the volcano. He's checking his score and he's shy like one coin or something. There's just this audible like. All right, so I mean, fast forward to 2015. Mm-hmm. And we're in kind of a transitional phase with Garrison now. You're doing a lot of reflection and making some life changes and all of this. And now you're back on the main channel. I know you took like a break and kind of played on an alt channel for a while. I mean, you're back to the underscore TT.
I'm pretty much on that channel full time. Originally, I switched over partly because I liked the atmosphere of a smaller stream better, but to be honest, it was because I got offered a name change and I couldn't take it because my stream was partnered. It's just like, oh, I'd rather have Gary.
Yeah.
But I recently wanted to make some changes to my life because I haven't been really too satisfied with where it's going. So I'm changing a lot of things. Like, I'm looking for new work. I'm going to be moving out of my house in the very near future. And I just sort of thought about it. Just like, you know what? I've never been so... I haven't been one to like hate on people who take money from streaming or whatever, but I've also never wanted it myself. So I decided, you know what, I could really use some additional income, even if it's small.
Mm-hmm.
And I just viewed it as like another opportunity, and people have just been,
and
I got so much support from it. I was floored, really.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's pretty impressive just the amount of people who have. I mean, you only announced it just a couple days ago. You're going back to the channel and all of that, right? So,
mm-hmm. Yeah, I got I basically got a DM. It's just like, hey, someone's sending you the sub application. I was just like, okay, cool. And then like, I've only streamed on it twice, and I have almost 40 subs. And
nice,
wow. Really amazing. I have never. Really felt, I mean, so. Liked in anything.
The other thing to think about too is, I mean, when you first had the chance, you know, you go back, it was almost, I think, 2 years ago now at this point, right? Mm-hmm. When you had that, there was still kind of a stigma there associated with becoming a sub channel. There were still people were kind of, you know, ooh, are we okay with this? Like, you know, we might have to look at him differently when we pass him on the street or something. But I feel like it's definitely not the case anymore. I feel like people are more accepting of it. They, you know, it's not really something that is worth getting mad at somebody about if they go for it. You're it's just more like another way to support somebody that you enjoy watching. So
I'm glad that the community has kind of changed their mind about it. All thanks to I Ate Your Pie and Stream Big.
That's right. See if we can get a few Stream Big faces in the chat there. I'm sure we've got a few. So, I mean, looking forward here, I mean, you've been playing Donaldland since you mm-hmm. moved back to the channel. I mean, are there other games that you're hoping to, you know, look forward to either for AGDQ or just like games you want to get back to, something like that?
My AGDQ plan definitely, we'll see if it gets in or not, but I'm going to be submitting Burst Chaser Cross Air Sliding, as well as I hope you and a few other people do the same so we can have that four-way race that we wanted.
Sounds good to me.
I'm also going to be trying to figure out Steven Seagal is the final option for the Super Nintendo game. It's really entertaining for just terrible reasons. It's like Time Cop, if you remember Time Cop.
Yep.
But it's completable. I've seen like some YouTube playthrough of it, but every time I've tried to play it, it crashes in the exact same spot. So we'll see if I can find out how to avoid the crash. I'm definitely submitting it to AGDQ.
I mean, I feel like your pitch just could end with the title of the game. If they don't accept a Steven Seagal game, I don't know.
Steven Seagal really is the final option.
You have no other option. This is it. That's your strategy too. When you go to submit it, you make it the fifth game that you submit. Ooh. So that it is the final option. There we go. Nice.
Yeah, just submit a bunch of other random filler, you know.
Yeah.
Yep. I've got a few other filler things. I'll probably submit Donald Lane, which probably won't get in. What else was I going to do? Me and Stryker were talking about doing Namco Star Wars, the Famicom one, where Darth Vader turns into a scorpion in level one.
Nice. Well, good. That's really promising, what I saw.
This seems like it'd be an actual interesting run. And no, not Strider, sorry.
Not Strider.
Gary's like the one person, don't talk about Strider too.
That's right.
That was one of the people who was going to race it too. Me and DP.
You're the only one who didn't go back and change his mind afterwards. Like, Used Pizza was having second thoughts in the practice room, started playing it, started winning money playing it. Which he wasn't even wagering. People were throwing money at him for doing well at Strider. It was,
great. Some Canadian money.
Yeah. I don't know what you can buy with this one Canadian dollar, but here you go. But yeah. Interesting. Oh, we got a question here for, I guess we'll save most of the questions for later, but since it's been asked, what about Huddins?
I've always said, I've been saying this for years, but Hudson's Adventure Island will be my final speedrun game. So whenever I do learn that, you know, it's the end of times for me.
Okay. So we don't want to learn that anytime soon.
Yeah.
We
gotta, that'd be a bit bittersweet.
Yeah. Save that one for a while. But at least it's good to know that at some point.
It's going to happen before I'm done speedrunning.
There we go.
All right.
Giano's time will fall. That's... I mean, I'm sure it has at this point, but
it's a good way to go down.
that's the next goal. Take out Giano. So, all right. Well, chat, if you have any questions for Garrison, save them for later in the show. We'll get back to that and do some Q&A at the end. But for now, we've got to talk about some of the real talk topics of the week. And you can already tell I made a mistake because we talked about that one last week. So there's my one mistake for the show.
It happens.
I'm allowed one. So SGDQ feedback is the category, and the question is, what are your thoughts of YouTube gaming? It's really we really nailed that one. So
SGDQ feedback did really well on YouTube gaming.
Yeah, I think they did a great job of avoiding YouTube gaming. That's All right. So in all seriousness, though, YouTube Gaming debuted this week, and we've seen a few people take attempts at streaming on it already. What do you guys in the chat and you guys in the call think so far? What are your initial impressions of YouTube Gaming, if you've had a chance to kind of look at it yet? What do you think? Is it the Twitch killer that they promise it will be?
It's really hard to tell at this point. Like, it's really hard to kind of displace people from what they're used to. People love familiarity and comfortability. Or
is it comfortability?
Comfortability. So, like, you know, it's really hard to just, like, say, oh, hey, go to YouTube Gaming. No, people aren't going to move there, especially as long as streamers aren't streaming there. Why would viewers go there? So, no, I mean, I don't see YouTube Gaming as just being that sudden, oh, hey, it's now number one. It's completely surpassed Twitch now. That's going to take time. But I kind of fiddle around with it a little bit. You know, it's, I don't think it's terrible. You know, at least it's pretty decent. Like, it's nice that they kind of feature, like, because it's YouTube, they can feature, like, the live streams and run into that. Hey, check out these videos, too. So, you know, it's kind of cool to get that aspect of it. You know, they got to have that tie-in, so it's not just streams and or highlights.
Interesting to note, too, that you've been exporting all of your Twitch videos to YouTube over the years, and now YouTube's ready to just use them on your own YouTube page now. So you stream on YouTube, and they're like, oh, hey, look at all these other videos. Yeah, over 3 years of content, courtesy of Twitch exports. I don't know.
I think my biggest issue is, maybe there's probably a way to fix it because I didn't fiddle around much, is when you click on a streamer streaming, rather than saying like twitch.tv/thebigboy, you get like youtube.com and their typical URL, like watch and then like yw4x7.
Oh, you get like, short code.
It's really like kind of like annoying to me. It's like, hey guys, check out, you know, check out Golden on YouTube Gaming. And then you see this like garbage link and it's like, oh, okay. But like, I don't know, it's a minor complaint, I guess, but it's just kind of unsettling to me. But other than that, I think it looks pretty decent.
Gary, have you had a chance to look at it, at any of YouTube Gaming at all? Or are you enticed by it at all? Do you want to try it out?
I don't know, to be honest. I'm not too sold on the idea, especially when I heard about the content stuff, like and taking your stream down live.
Yeah.
I don't really feel like that's going to do too well for old video games.
Yeah, I think that's kind of a big deal. And people have been bringing it up in chat already, too. But the kind of the big difference is that it seems like, you know, at first people complained when Twitch VODs would get muted. But by comparison, getting your live stream taken down because they've got real-time content matching, that seems a little bit worse, I think, for the streamer.
Yeah. Yeah, that's just definitely the bit. Death knell of the idea of someone streaming there, in my opinion.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think as Darkman pointed out, kind of the target audience for this, I feel like they really are trying to capture their streamers. And by that, I mean like YouTube personalities. They want to keep them on YouTube. So it does seem like that's kind of their main focus with the service.
Right.
And maybe it would take something drastic for people to kind of jump ship again. You know, like you know, every time something bad happens on Twitch, people say like, "Oh, pack up and go to Hitbox." Like maybe maybe now the mentality would be pack up and go to YouTube, or I don't know. So,
oh yeah, I mean, it could be a tiered approach kind of thing where it's like, hey, first let's make the people that already broadcast, you know, that give their videos on YouTube, our biggest like supporters. Let's give them their shot at it.
Right.
Give them time to get comfortable with it, and if they give out the good word, well, that's going to spread. And eventually, if somebody gets fed up with Twitch, they're going to be like, well, I heard so many good things about YouTube Gaming, let me just switch over real quick. I mean, you got people watching it, so it's not like I feel like I'm going to have a big, you know, audience lower, you know.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing to think about, too, is that, you know, they might have the technical prowess, and I don't think anybody's going to question that they can do whatever they want with the site and make it as technologically advanced as they want to. The question's going to be is the community going to follow? Because Twitch has kind of an established community now, and so how do you convince people that are already a part of that to jump over and try that out? So I think what you might see is that, kind of like with Hitbox, you know, sometimes people will stream to Hitbox every now and then. I still feel like you're going to see a lot of that where people are going to stick to the site they use already and then maybe dabble a little bit in YouTube Gaming. So
I think one thing we didn't discuss is, from what I understand, like certain countries, like, you know how YouTube is with like countries viewing certain videos.
Yep.
It's no different with streaming. So, I mean, if you're already excluding certain countries, like I remember some people talking on Twitter about Germany, like not being able to view a lot of the streams. So, I mean, if you're off to that kind of start, like, that's not going to bode well for the future, because Germany, I mean, so many people from Germany, like, you know, watch online content and stuff, so it's not good.
Mm-hmm. All right. Looks like the chat was pretty active on that one, so we'll let them calm down a little bit here. I'm just kidding. You guys are going to get even more into the next topic here, I think. You guys will have a lot to say on this one. And that is a speedrun breakdown, not to be confused with the speedrunner breakdown. I fully expected. I typed in speedrunbreakdown.com, and I expected to see, like, the latest flea market buys of a certain Super Meat Boy runner. But instead, I was brought back to twitch.tv/trihex, where I discovered that Trihex is announcing a new speedrunning website. The idea of it is that it's going to be kind of a focal point for tutorial videos, specifically for speedruns. And he kind of gave a whole presentation on this and, like, what his plans are for the site. I'm going to kind of break this into two questions. The first one is, do you think that tutorials need some sort of central site like this? Is that something that would be of value? And then secondly, do you think Trihex's solution to this or approach to this is what answers that question then?
Well, before we even answer those two questions, let me say that I actually recommend everybody read his presentation, because I read it before the show, and his points are they couldn't be more spot on, in my opinion, in regards to the speedrunning community. Like, there is a lot of good points, very accurate and truthful points about this community, so I highly recommend everybody read them. So as for the questions, yes, I honestly really think there needs to be a central resource for tutorials. So, like we were talking about it last week about the whole, you know, paying for speedrunning lessons, there's a reason why somebody would do that. It's because there is an issue with accessibility in this community. We don't see it as much because we're within the community. We know who to talk to. It's not the case for the thousands of other, tens of thousands of people even, that are watching speedrunning streams, that they don't really know where to start. And even if they know where to start, they don't know if they can talk to those people. Like, you know, like, could you imagine a random viewer trying to go up to Caleb Hart and saying, "Hey, Caleb, can you, like, help me out with this MMX thing?" He has, like, 1,000+ viewers on his stream regularly. I mean, not necessarily because he's just being a douche or anything. It's because you can't help 1,000 people at once, you know, it's simply too hard. Right. So it's nice to have a website like this that can cater to those people by putting tutorials out there. From what he was saying, it was, there'd be very brief videos, no more than 10 minutes, a lot of content on them, and not kind of like the flair that you may see on other maybe potential tutorials. And to your second question as to whether his website is the right thing, it doesn't matter who does it. It kind of does, because you want obviously somebody that's, you know, known to bring this out, otherwise nobody's going to pay attention to it. But as long as the website is done tastefully and done well, it doesn't really matter who does it. So I think it'll be perfectly fine. Like, I believe that Trihex can bring a product like this. Like, I definitely think he's the right person for this job. So I'm in full support of it. I think it's a great idea.
Garrison, what do you think?
You know, I didn't catch any of the live stream because I was streaming at the time, and I just saw my chat blowing up at Trihex and looking at IRC.
Yeah.
But, you know, to the point of people having tutorials, they're a good thing. They're a good reference point, but I also feel like people learn differently in general. Sure. So I don't know how you would approach that on just one universal scale, because I've learned just different games in different ways, and I'm sure a lot of other people are going to be the same, so I'm not really sure how ultimately useful it's going to be, but it's just way better than nothing. I feel like it at least sets a precedent for more things that are similar, even if it isn't a success.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's a couple things going on here. I think that, like, from Trihex's perspective, this is a learning opportunity for him to kind of dabble in this, you know, like, if it's successful, that's great. If it's not, maybe he learned something from it, just about, you know, website design or community or, like, whatever aspect you want to take from it, he can learn something from it. But I think another question is, you know, what is going to make this site the one that works? Because this has been attempted before. I mean, SDA had like the resources section where they were going to try to kind of culminate all of the tutorials. Speedrun.com's got their own section that's devoted to tutorials. The question is, like, what about the site is, you know, or about any site, not just the one that Trihex is announcing, but what about the site is going to make it the center point for tutorials? You know, people have to be able to be motivated to upload the tutorials they have to it.
I think it's like, it's a good question. I think there's a really simple answer to that is, like, you look at SDA's knowledge base, and there's no offense to SDA, but it's just text. And sometimes the explanations aren't very detailed, so you kind of have to figure it out. I mean, like, I'm posing this question to both of you guys. Like, there's obviously been a time where you've been learning a speed game and you have to ask somebody else what's going on because you're not quite sure yourself. Like, we've all had that question at some point, whether it's a small detail or a really big question. So everybody has those questions. And sometimes the resources that we have right now aren't necessarily a good solution without talking to somebody. So I think that's what Speedrun Breakdown is trying to bridge that gap between. Whereas, yeah, maybe they still need that kind of personal attention, but I think these tutorial videos, if they're done right, will probably answer a lot more questions than something like SDA's knowledge base was able to.
Sure. Now, I guess I'll throw this question out there too, because I've heard this one a couple of times, and I'll let you guys, you can answer it, anybody that wants to. But a lot of people have been saying, as kind of a devil's advocate to this, that the best way to learn a game is to sit down and play the game. And, you know, if you, whether that's looking at the record video or a tutorial or whatever, what, you know, I think, I guess one of the, I don't know how to word this without, because it's going to sound like it's too easy and you can just, like, knock down my point. But I guess, like, one of the things I heard from a lot of people was that what about this is going to suddenly make tutorials better, or, you know, how is that going to make people catch up to where all the top players are? Because the top players, I mean, it's pretty obvious that they're practicing all the time. They're, you know, questioning everything. They're opening up emulators. They're looking for frame savers. You know, how does that get translated then? Or do we not, is this more of a beginner's website then? You know, is it really just about, like, I watch Mario 64 once a week, and I think it'd be really cool to learn it as something that I can show my friends. You know, I think that's part of it too.
Yeah, I mean, so, definitely.
I don't know where my question went with that. I think I lost my question somewhere in there. But
I kind of lost you there too. But yeah, kind of got the idea.
Yeah, just throwing some ideas. I'm throwing some ideas out there. So I don't know. I'm interested to see what happens with it. At least I do think that kind of the take home from this is that I do think people want some sort of centered resource for tutorials. And you know, if all they're asked to do is provide a link or something, you know, like, hey, this tutorial still exists, you know. Because right now, a lot of games, game communities have that tutorial. You know, there's a Sunshine tutorial. There's, I mean, Siglemic 70 Star, if you want to go back that far. But, you know, just to give examples, I mean, there are tutorials out there. It's just a matter of knowing the right people at this point. You know, you have to know who to ask or where to find the video.
I think honestly, mostly our tutorial scene is mostly about talking to people. I don't feel like it's in the form of videos. I mean, yeah, there's definitely videos out there, don't get me wrong, but I think it's more so just talking to people and watching it run. And the, you know, those two kind of fill in any sort of loose ends you may not know. So I definitely think, you know, tutorial videos are going to bridge that gap a long way. And I know people in chat were asking, like, why Trihex? He's a really, like, engaging guy. Like, he knows how to commentate. He knows how to talk to people. Like, he knows what to explain. Like, you know, taking his game, like, he knows everything about that game. He knows what to explain in his game. And I'm sure his goal is, well, I want to find more people like that. And he even found people for his own game. It's not like he's just the only one that's going to be doing it for Yoshi's Island. No, he's got, like, three or four other people. So he wants to, I'm sure he wants to find more people like that with other games rather than just say, oh, hey, you know, we're just going to do it for Yoshi's Island and that's it, because that's all I know. So it's a very ambitious idea, but, and, you know, it may, you know, not be that great in the beginning, but I think if it's done right, I think it could definitely take off well.
I think so. I think we'll cut it off there too, or we could be talking about it for another hour or something. So we'll see what happens with it anyway. One point I want to make before we transition, because I'm going to forget this, but so Trihex told me about this when we were at Evo. He explained this project idea that he had, but he didn't want to announce it. He told this right. Now understand that I'm telling you the story here, so this is my remembering of it, and it could be wrong, but he told me he was going to get the Yoshi's Island record first. He told me he wanted the Yoshi's Island record first, then he was going to announce it. I don't see that record. I don't see it. Trihex, come on, man. I believe in you. You can do it.
Trihex on blast. Come
let's
on
get
now.
That record. I'm calling you out. Get that record. Let's go. But all right. That's how I remember hearing it. So mm-hmm. Could be wrong. I might have heard something there. But all right, we'll move on. Get yourself speedrunning wrapped up. Last weekend with the race of Pokemon Red and Blue, and that is the end of the Get Yourself Speedrunning SGDQ edition. So we had Pokemon Red Blue last weekend. The weekend before that we had Meat Boy, and the weekend before that we had Mario Kart 64. Did you guys get a chance to watch any of this at all, or I guess what are your thoughts on Get Yourself Speedrunning, how they did this time around?
Yeah, I didn't really get much of a chance to watch them, unfortunately, but there's definitely a little bit lower entrance, I feel like, on some of the games than the other ones when they did the first edition, which is just understandable. I mean, when you have like a simple short category like Link to the Past, Master Sword, you're going to get a billion people in there. Like, so that's definitely understandable, but I like the game choices. They're cool. They're varied. It's not just, hey, let's do an NES platformer or a SNES platformer. You know, they went out there, did Mario Kart 64, and, you know, even did a game that people had to buy, even though, like, it seems like the whole world owns Super Meat Boy at this point. But, yeah. You know, it's I like the kind of direction they took with it. My only thing was maybe Pokemon Beat the Game might have been a bit too long, but it's still got, like, 90 entrants, so...
Yeah, I mean, I feel like that's kind of just pulling off the popularity of the series there. Like, no matter what goal they put there, mm-hmm. they'd still get a lot of entrants, so that was cool.
Yeah, so it's nice. You know, it's a nice take on things. I'm glad people showed up. So I'm glad they do these things, and I'm looking forward to more of them. So hopefully we'll see more of them.
Yeah, I mean, this time around, they had a sponsorship, too, from Elgato Gaming. They were giving mm-hmm. away capture cards there, so some people got a chance to win some prizes for participating. I think that might have encouraged more people to join, because it wasn't just going to, like, the first place person. It was, like, if you finish in the top 25% of people, you could win or whatever. So more people had a chance to win and motivation to stick around even after the first person finished.
Right.
One thing I will say that I think is a continued challenge to them is... How do you present this as get yourself speedrunning and then only show the top four runners of each game to begin with? Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, they do, after the four runners finish, they'll show people who are still racing that aren't the top four. But I almost wonder, is there a way you can strike a balance where you could show, you know, some good runners and then some players who are, you know, maybe not familiar with the game to demonstrate more of the point that anybody can do it? Like, I remember there was the Ocarina of Time challenge that Cosmo had with mm-hmm. the, I don't remember, it was like beat four dungeons with...
beat the forest temple with iron boots.
The forest temple, that's what it was, yeah.
Or something like that.
Yeah. And when that stream was going on, I think there were different scenes, and they would just flip back and forth. They wouldn't even, like, keep the same person on the entire time. They would just kind of check in on people, like, oh, this is how this person's doing. And on each screen, you would have a mix of really good players and players who were just in the race without any clue what they were doing. So you had a mix of skill levels. And it wasn't so much about, like, oh, keep that screen on at all times. I have to see how that person's always doing. But it was just more of, like, this is kind of the gamut of how good mm-hmm. people are. These are really good players. Here's players who are just struggling and learning for the first time. So I almost wonder if you have to do something like that or if that would even work. I don't know.
I don't see why not. It's something different. Like, I feel like, yes, we're trying to appeal to new speedrunners, but still, its core audience is people that are familiar with these games. So it's like, why not try to do something different, kind of engage more people, get people interested in it? Even if you get more people that have already started speedrunning already, like, to race it, it's never a bad thing to get more people interested. So, I don't know, I think it would be kind of a neat idea to explore. Like, especially in a game like, you know, Pokemon Red Blue, like, it's a 2-hour game, so there's plenty of downtime. So yeah. You can definitely sneak moments in there.
Yeah, I mean, even if you wanted to have like the four main runners on the one scene, you could have a second scene ready to go whenever there's downtime to like cut over and look at people quick, even if it's only for a few seconds or something, just be like, oh, that's how, you know, this runner is that you might have heard of, but you're not associating with this game. Or, I don't know. So just a thought. I mean, I think overall it went pretty well. I think that the number of people who entered each game was pretty good. About 100 for each game. So a little bit under for the first two. So I think what I heard from Blecky as well with regards to the next Get Yourself Speedrunning after HDQ is maybe some more risks. They took risks this time around, but I think they said they want to try even more just kind of exploring what kind of games will work for people. So it'll be interesting to see what game lineup they come up with there, because I do think that's kind of a big deal too. What games they pick kind of determines the attendance there. So
definitely,
for sure.
I mean, do we have a favorite Get Yourself Speedrunning race that's happened so far? There's been six of them total.
I personally love the Link to the Past one because it was such a short and easy goal. Like, it's like all you had to do is, even if you don't know the game, literally just have like a one-page document in front of you.
Yeah.
Go this, this, and this. Mm-hmm. Like, it's such a simple goal that I was probably my favorite one out of them all.
We've got Ice Plugs, Get Yourself Speedrunning with Kaizo, Mario, Bashi, and Bucky O'Hard. That'll be a...
Yep. Good choices.
Good choices there. It'll be a good event. All right.
Link to the Past was good, though. 300 racers, that race.
That race was insane, the amount of people who were in that. Yeah. I mean, that was kind of the first... No, first or second. There were a couple races before that, I think, that kind of broke race spot. There was the Mario 64. And then there was Christos Owens' Link to the Past race that blew up, too. Yeah. That was... Yeah.
And then Mega Man 2 anniversary race just completely broke had to down be, race spot.
Had to be split into two races because there were so many players. Yeah. All right. Well, we'll see what happens with Get Yourself Speedrunning. I think it went pretty well, though, and we'll expect more after HDQ. Let's move on and talk about our record of the week. And when I say talk about, I'm gonna note that neither Darkman or I is very knowledgeable about the game. I don't know about Gary, but we've got Jak and Daxter Any% in 5850 by Headstrong. And the last I remember of Jak and Daxter, actually. This game was sitting over an hour for the longest time. I mean, 103 was kind of a milestone that seemed important. So I don't know what's all been improved here. But we've got Headstrong here. And Headstrong, by the way, worth noting, he's been around for a long time. This is a guy that's been streaming on SRL for probably 3-4 years, maybe more than that. If you could even go that far, but I feel like he's been there since the beginning of SRL.
He's definitely been a name for quite a while. I mean, hey, 58 minutes, cut the 59. That's always good in my book, so congrats, man. I don't know anything about Jak and Daxter. But...
Same, man.
You know, this is one of those that I just wish I had a better understanding, because, I mean, obviously Jak and Daxter has a lot of complicated jumps to it, and the platforming is very precise. You've got a lot of vehicle sections like you're seeing here. This isn't the only one of those, but I do feel like this is a game that doesn't quite get the attention that it probably should, just because it is kind of a headlining game for Sony. And I think since the GDQ run, I mean, I don't feel like it's gotten a lot of attention, so...
Well, it's just kind of like Sony, like PS1, PS2 platformers in general. They just get like no attention at all. And there's definitely a lot of solid titles in there. I mean, you have the Crash series, you have Jak and Daxter. I mean, there's just a lot of good options. Hey, one of my personal favorites, Jumping Flash. It's a great game. But there's a lot of really solid platformers on the PS1 especially. And, you know, of course, we have Rayman. How could we forget Rayman? You know, they definitely do need some more love. I guess the problem is kind of accessibility, with the fact that it's not really easy to emulate it. I mean, it's not terribly difficult, but, you know, for people with, like, older computers, it's just not going to happen. So I'm sure that's part of the reason. And also, of course, everybody has nostalgia for SNES and NES.
Is this one of those games?
Oh, is it PS2? Okay.
Yeah, is this one of those games that's plagued by the like fast disk speed and like you got to have the right PS2? And...
Pretty much every PlayStation 2 game, to my understanding, has that issue. That may be part of why PlayStation games have so much difficulty developing a scene, is just because you have just consoles matter.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if you want to play at the highest level, so to speak, I mean, if you don't want to make any time conversions or anything, yeah, that seems like a tough thing to have to deal with. So it's an interesting run. And by the way, as a bonus incentive to get you to go to the link there, I want you to go check out the replay. And then I want you to make as many comparisons as you can between Headstrong's bio and Oxus's bio, because they have a lot of the same interests.
Oh, and, yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah. Dude, Headstrong has the greatest like bio in the history of Twitch. Like, yep. I highly recommend it.
It's really good. It's really cute, and it never ends. It just keeps going. There's like, just when you think you've run out of boxes, there are more.
I got to be real. Like, it's better than Oxus's.
Better than Oxus's. Yeah. All right, you said it, not me. But but there you go. So go on over there and check out the run, and give Headstrong a follow. Okay. So now this is the part of the show where we move on and we make fun of someone else, right? Someone else?
Yeah, someone else.
Someone else.
Do you have anybody in mind, Golden?
Yeah, I mean, I think there was one submitted this week, so I think we'll go ahead and use that one. Is that okay? Can we?
Okay.
We can use that one. Are you sure?
So, I mean, is somebody we know? Or?
Yeah, I mean, it's somebody in chat. We're just going to use one of theirs.
Oh, okay. All right, well, I hope it's a good one.
Okay, you're not playing off me here. Let me try that again. I'm gonna use somebody from chats.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah, are you gonna stop me?
No, not really. Why? Why would I? I mean, you know, we got some good viewers. They submit some funny clips.
They do. They're pretty good about that. Yeah.
But you know, I mean, we don't have to take somebody from chat. We could take somebody else. Okay.
Who?
I don't know. You know, we got. There's three two co-hosts right now, and there's a guest. I mean, do you want to take somebody from the? Do you want to take the guest?
I would rather take a guest than
a co-host.
The other option, if that's what you're implying. Yeah.
Well, I mean, yeah. I mean, you know, I'd be kind of mean to do it from the guest. Like, there are guests. You know, yeah. If we're going to make fun of somebody on the stream,
we should make fun of one of us then. Okay. Yeah. All right. I'm glad we narrowed that down.
So I don't want to make fun of me. So how about you?
Okay. Fine. That was a really roundabout way to get there, but I liked it. That was good. All right, we worked for that. All right, so this is a glitch, please, and unfortunately this week I'm the highlight. So here we go. We got Mega Man 8. Fantastic game that it is. I'll shut up because I'm talking in the clip.
Why did you call it over the spikes?
What? Half that room was stable.
It was like maybe a third of it was stable.
Newsflash, Astro crushes the platform you're on and drops you into spikes.
All right, so context here. I'm looking for Rush Coil. I don't have any idea what the red boxes are, and this is about to be bad.
What was that? I just got killed by Rush.
Wait, what?
Apparently the new really power the best thing is Rush spiked the stone that you're standing on now.
Good self-sabotage.
Wow.
Yeah.
Did we have to show that? Did we have to make that known? All right.
Yeah, we did. It was so good.
It's Mega Man 8 in a nutshell right there. Yeah. That perfectly describes my experience during the game, too. I think that's it's a pretty accurate slice of the playthrough.
Man, I was hoping, like, Rush would, like, damage you, too. I mean, you know, if he damages Rock standing, I want to just hit you, you know, for the full effect.
Yeah. Just to rub it in. I don't know. Yeah. I liked that I couldn't stay away from the spikes, so I had to have spikes drop me onto spikes. That was, yeah.
I'm sad that you didn't include the first part of it. That was good, too.
Oh, yeah, that's good. For the full extended behind-the-scenes clip, check out my YouTube later tonight. I'll put it up there. But there's more. There's more shenanigans than just that. But, yeah, I was not doing so well there. So if you have a clip, an emphasis on you so we don't have to keep making fun of me. If you have a clip of something funny happening to you, either in a speedrun or blind race or just casually playing a game, and you want to share it, on the stream, you should send it to us. thefinalsplit at gmail.com, or you can go over to thefinalsplit.com and you can use our form that's on the site there. So you have multiple ways to get a hold of us, and we'll hopefully use one of your clips right up. I can never do this.
Yeah,
up there somewhere. That's why you're in the top right corner.
It's cine-acquired art.
All right, let's get some questions for Gary here as we end the show. Has anybody got any questions for Gary? I have a question for everybody in the call, and that is, what's going on this weekend? What are you streaming? What's the plan?
Lots and lots of work.
Streaming work.
Streaming work, yeah.
All right. That's too bad.
Yeah, what can you do?
Gary, you got any stream plans?
I want to say I had plans, but I don't remember what they are, so I'll probably just play Donald Land and do something else.
That works.
I've been trying to one credit clear the sixth Toho game, because I recently started playing those games just to kind of understand like why there's this fan base.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of been a thing.
So are you getting close to the 1cc? Or?
Oh, yeah. I get to the final boss pretty regularly.
Nice.
Is final boss just like a huge wall, or?
It's just I'm so tired at that point. I have no lives, so just the smallest mistake is just like, oh, got to start over.
All right. From Stryker, we got a question. What's it like to be the greatest manager of all time?
Considering the work, the dedication, and just the sweat beating off of my brow, it's been a pleasure.
Yeah. I mean, it does sound like you put in just a ton of effort, so...
I retweet pretty regularly. I tell people to buy his EP. I was telling people to buy his shirt, and then people bought his shirt, including me. So I'd say it's been a big success so far.
What a dedicated manager. He buys his own.
Yeah. Cassius says, do you want to move in and create a speed apartment?
Oh, definitely. I'll be there this weekend since I have no plans.
Nice. There we go. I think that's a great idea. We have what does the underscore TT stand for?
I used to post on a forum called Talking Time, which kind of stemmed from a video games journalism website. And I posted there for a couple years, and that's when I first started streaming, was when I was a regular there, and I just like everything else in life, I got a little bit jaded and decided to leave.
Yeah.
So it's followed me like an awful ghost since then.
Just can't get rid of it, yeah.
Yep.
Jagger G says, as an NES fan, are you excited about the Big 20 race?
I've always had an interest in joining one of those, but it's so many games.
It is. It's a lot, yeah.
Like, if it was a Big 8,
yeah,
I'd be down.
You know, I always wondered that. When we first started talking about these, I thought, too, you know, would more people join it if it was 10 games or 5 games instead of 20? And I feel like that's just kind of a decision that they want to go with. They want it to be 20. That's kind of what they, you know, bad breaks.
I respect it. I'm just a baby, I guess.
Yeah. I do think 20 is intimidating for a lot of people. I mean, obviously, the people who do it are giants, and it's impressive to watch them do it. But yeah, you got to be pretty dedicated to do one of those. Bore Deathly wants to know if you'll play Bucky again.
If I can find it or find a way to make it work on cart, or if I can get a cart, they're kind of rare, so it's not very easy to do. I installed some new save state mappers on my flash cart so I could practice games, and Bucky seems to be the only casualty of that because it just like lags and has horrible graphical issues now.
Okay.
That's a real shame.
We got people buying Striker's EP in chat still, so that's good.
Yeah, man.
Let's see. What game would you race with us, the final split hosts?
Any game you want.
All right, what are we going to race?
Pilot Wings. I raced Pilot Wings with Sammy Twiggin.
Were you a part of that?
Awful.
Okay,
was.
So everybody
I was
here
like stuck on the third trainer forever.
We all can relate. Yeah. I Dark Man submitted Pilot Wings to the last mystery tournament and I had to play that.
So this is I'm gonna sort the tiers here. So we got Gary's tier is awful game. I hate this game, I wanna kill it. Golden is this game sucks, but I won a mystery tournament race, so it can't be that terrible. And my tier is Pilot Wings is the greatest game of all time.
And where does Sumi fall into this? She's got a timer on the screen when she's playing it.
Ooh, so speedrunning it, man. She's going crazy. Yeah. I told her, how does it feel to be better at a video game than a professional speedrunner?
I mean, between her and Twig, they must have the only two times.
Dude, Twig's got the world record.
Yeah. So we'll look and see how that game develops. That's
the fastest known completion of the video game.
Yeah. Let's see. Oh, I thought Jack had a question, but he's just talking. What do you think about developers trying to find speedrunners to play their game?
What do I think about it? I really like the fact that developers are kind of heading towards the speedrun community instead of just patching out all our tricks.
That's cool, yeah.
I really enjoy that.
It's kind of neat when
it's nice to see like all the speedrun modes or whatever.
Yeah, and it's nice when they acknowledge it and they just leave it in there or put something back in. That's cool.
Yeah.
And you're seeing a lot of games now have like a speedrun mode too, which is kind of interesting.
Yeah.
Just time trials. Time trials and racing games and stuff like that were always fun. I'm glad to see it crossing over to like Mega Man 9, Mega Man 10 are good examples of that. I would love to see time trials in pretty much every game.
Let's see. All right, I'm not sure if there's a good answer to this one, but we'll try it. Most ridiculous speed game mechanic you've ever seen? I don't even know. I guess I'd say like Kirby Superstar Plasma. Like, I don't know what you're looking for there, but
it's a loaded question. I don't know.
Depends on how you want to say ridiculous. Like, as far as just looking just absolutely stupid, Donald Lenz. Apple jumps into the scroll glitch is just really dumb looking.
Yeah.
I have to say, just like the absurdity of like any like old school like RPG, like that's like totally busted, like Final Fantasy 1 and Final Fantasy 3, where it's just like a bunch of overflowed nonsense just like spewing all over the screen. That always makes me like laugh at that stuff.
Going up and down stairs forever.
Yeah.
Oh, I should have just said Castlevania 4 stairs. That's probably the most ridiculous mechanic I've ever seen. That's not just specific to speedruns, though. That's just in the game. Okay. Dark Terex wants to know what the first thing you would tell somebody is that's learning DKC1.
The way I learned DKC1 is I decided to route the entire thing out by myself. And once I cut the arbitrary goal of 40 minutes, I learned real strats so I'd have a better understanding of the mechanics of the game and why their strats are superior over mine.
I mean, do you think just for any game, not just Donkey Kong Country, do you think it's best to just be like immerse yourself in it, start playing instead of starting off by watching videos? I mean, like what do you think? How do you generally
learn? Really depends. That's definitely my preferred method. I've done a little bit of everything. I've done the grinding in the lab and then do like world record caliber runs. I've done just a lot of methods. As far as the most fun way to do it, I definitely just recommend playing the game as much as you can and just slowly adapting other things in. So you have a good backbone of the knowledge. You understand why certain things are this way and that way. And that knowledge tends to make you question things because you've had this dumb idea that you had that was really slow and bad.
Yeah.
But you can use that knowledge and apply it somewhere else and, hey, you just save some time.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it definitely kind of helps to at least kind of do a playthrough of the game, I feel like, because you kind of get like an understanding of the mechanics. So it's not just like, oh, hey, he did this. I'm not understanding this at all. Well, I feel like at least if you play through the game once, it kind of makes a little bit more sense. Maybe not fully, but I don't know. That's the way I found it in the past. So I try to at least do like a full gameplay through, whether it's save states or just, you know, casual. So.
Mm-hmm.
All right. We'll leave it at that and we'll go ahead and move on to everybody's favorite segment, the speech. I'm not sure. The speech, are we?
Speech, question mark?
Do we have one? Is that's probably the more important question.
Maybe. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll do one.
Go for it.
So, shout out to viewers in chat right now. Cosmic the Dolphin pointed this out via Twitter. Thank you. There is the first Kirby's Dream Land 1 tourney going on. So, bunch of runners. I believe it's just starting today or yesterday. Let's see how many. We got about 25 people in there. You know, Kirby's Dream Land 1, really easy, easy game, like blind, you can do it in like 20 minutes. Like it's really easy. Pretty, neat in that it's really accessible. So it's kind of cool to see, like, you know, a game like Kirby's Dream Land getting the attention and seeing like 25 people enter it. So, oh, starting today. That's good. So all the matches, from what I understand, are being streamed over at, well, I will paste the link in chat.
Okay.
So they're all trying to stream it all to this place. I guess they may not get every match, but it's kind of cool that they're doing it that way. Yeah, short game, easy to watch. Look forward to it.
All right. Do we have a raid target in mind? Gary, do you want to look up somebody to raid? Is there somebody you're looking for? And then you're doing that, we'll just remind everybody that we'll be back next Thursday, 8 p.m. Eastern. And notice I finally fixed the date there, so it's not August 13th anymore. Yeah. I thought about leaving it there just like one more time, but let's get it right instead there. So yeah, next Thursday we'll be back with another show. So hopefully we'll see you all then. All right, who are we going for?
I've got a risky one.
Okay.
Because I don't know how long it's going to stay up.
All right. That's all right.
I like risky. I like it. All right, yeah, let's go with this. They're a big fan. I'm a big fan of, I should say. Sumi would call him the dreamiest streamboat in the speedrunning community. Whoa. That's our good friend.
Oh, absolutely.
That's our good friend, Dram. Dram,
streaming at this hour, that's unusual. Yeah, it's not 5 in the morning. That's you're not kidding when you say he might be offline very shortly. We better head over there quickly. Go ahead and give him the Donald Land raid. Apparently, that's what we're gonna say, Donald Land.
He's the dreamiest dreamboat of the speedrunning community.
Oh, okay. I saw Nacho say Donald Land. So, all right, either one. Dreamiest streamboat of the speedrunning community. All right, head on over and say hello to the very dreamy Dram, and enjoy the stream there. That's it for us, though. Gary, you want to give any quick shout-outs?
Shout-outs to the entire speedrun community for being great. And to Twitch.
Excellent. Well, couldn't have said it better. Nice and concise. We'll be back next Thursday night. So until then, just remember that your run is not over until you hit
the final split.
Thank you, Darkman. We'll have a good rest of the weekend, everybody. We'll see you.